Hi, I'm Fred McNeil, and thank you for watching QACTV 7. You're watching a program called Conversations with Fred. Each week, we have different people, men and women from the community, and they tell us about events that are about to happen, tell us about interesting things that might be going on, which I think you know, make the show interesting, but make your life a little more interesting. I have my good friend Paul Comfort with us today. Paul, thank you for being with us. Now, Paul, most of the people out there are going to know you were elected county commissioner in Queen Anne's County. You were a county administrator in Queen Anne's County. You certainly were the captain of, or you kicked the whole public transportation system going in Queen Anne's County. You're a good golfer. You're a good husband, right? You're a good parent, okay? But what most people don't know is that you write kids' books, and you write other books for adults on transportation. You're not only a local expert on transportation, not only a state expert, you're traveling all around the world. So today we'll talk about transportation, all right? How about introduce yourself, tell folks how you got involved in all this stuff?
Yeah, well, thanks, Fred.
Thanks for having
me on. Fred and I are good buddies. And part of the reason why I moved back to Queen Anne's County was because when I moved to Southern Maryland to become the county administrator,
we kept saying,
there,
come back.
Yeah, Fred said, Paul, we need you back. And so we've been back 9 years now and live out near Roosburg. So I'm having the time of my life now.
Good.
Started right here in Centerville, as you mentioned, and was the transportation coordinator for the Department of Aging. Started the county ride bus system.
You actually started it?
Yeah, I started
buses
it.
I got all the grants. Still going around,
I bought the buses with the grants. Worked with commissioners like Wheeler Baker and Bill Riggs and those guys to help get this thing started. And put up the bus stop signs myself, designed the routes myself.
Yeah, we had nothing before you started.
No. Yeah, and later on, as county administrator, I started this television station.
Okay,
QACTV.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, as you know, you were involved in helping me get that started.
Look, if it hadn't been for you, not only would the county not have the station, but the Board of Ed wouldn't have their meetings on, the town of Centerville. I mean, that kicked the whole thing off.
Right, yeah. So I did that for 7 years, Fred, right here in Queen Anne's County as transportation coordinator, and became president of the State Transportation Association, called TAM. And in 91, County Ride won the award for the best community transportation system in America.
Oh, wow.
And that really
the whole
kind of,
country.
Yeah, for the whole country. And that really kicked from the Community Transportation Association of America. So that really kicked off my career. Shortly after that, I got a call and was recruited to go work for a company that managed transit systems around the country. And so I went into business development, worked for a number of companies, and we won contracts, and I helped start up transit systems from Redmond, Washington, where we won a contract to run the Microsoft Corporation's on-campus shuttle system.
You can't be Microsoft.
45 minivans where you'd pick up a phone if you were an executive.
Did they give you any stock options or anything?
No, but it was fun going there.
Okay.
And you would go down in a minivan, pick you up all the way to the Virgin Islands, where we won a contract to win Vitran. In 97, I visited there 5 times. And then came back here, got involved more politically here, ran for state's attorney in 2002,
You're a lawyer. We might add, and I didn't, you are a lawyer.
Yes, I went to law school at night at University of Maryland while I was working for the county, one of my other jobs. And then didn't win for state's attorney. Frank won, became a good friend of mine, Frank Cradaville,
now
our district court judge.
Yeah.
But I became county administrator after that. Gene Ransom and all those guys picked me to be their county administrator, and it was a ball. Probably my favorite job I've ever had.
Okay.
So for 4 years, kind of ran the county government day-to-day as the chief operating officer, and then became president of the State County Administrators Association through MACO, and a lot of the other county administrators in the state, I went and helped them with their counties, and eventually one of them said, Paul, you should come to my county, Southern Maryland, in Charles County. I'm only doing this temporarily. I don't want this permanently. A guy named Roy. So I ended up moving over there for a few years and with the county administrator where La Plata and Waldorf and all that is, and helped them get their TV station really going.
Okay.
Built a million-dollar studio with money we had and grants and all that. And then got back into transportation after that for 5 years working in Washington, D.C., running their paratransit system, which is the van service for people with disabilities in Northern Virginia, Washington, D.C.
They just pick up a phone and say they need a ride.
Yeah, you make a reservation. We're doing 10,000 trips a day. We're the fourth largest in America.
10,000 a day.
I had 12 garages all over Maryland, D.C., and Virginia that I was over, and ran for county commissioner here in 2014, won as top vote getter. And today, it's funny, the day we're taping this is the day 6 years
July
ago.
July 2nd, 2021.
I resigned and gave the job to
Opportunity knock.
Yeah, our good buddy Jack Wilson, who's done a great job. I just saw him a couple weeks ago and told him what a great job he's done as county commissioner. Told him, don't worry, I'm not running against you this time. And so then Governor Hogan asked me to take over the transportation for the state at the MTA, the Maryland Transit Administration, which was one of the best jobs I've ever had. A lot of fun.
Okay.
You are the general manager of the Baltimore City Transit System when you're in this job. So that's the bus, the light rail, the subway, the commuter train, which is the MARC train service that goes into Washington, D.C. from all over Maryland, commuter buses, 350 motor coaches taking people into Baltimore. I started the extra routes coming off of Kent Island, remember? Mm-hmm. They had cut them back, and I wanted them to go back into Baltimore. And then the paratransit system. And so those six modes, plus we oversaw $100 million of funding.
What was the staff there?
So I had 5,000 employees and contractors, 3,300 employees and 2,000 contractors that work for us. When government tells you, we're going to cut the number of employees, they're lying to you usually is what I found out. All they do is outsource it. Yes, it costs twice as much. So they might as well keep the employees. But that's another issue.
No politics today. Yeah, exactly. I see your blood pressure goes. Having to help. This show is not to give you.
That's right. Yeah.
Now, you're playing golf in about a half an hour.
That's right.
That will give you heart palpitations.
There you go.
Please, not conversations.
Yeah, and I've lost 50 pounds in this year, so I feel great. That politicking, you know, you got all those chicken dinners and you put on some weight. So I'm embarrassed how much weight I gained, but happy at the weight loss. So anyway, did that for a couple years and then left there after 30 years in the industry. And now for the last 4 years, I've been able to have fun, travel the world, working for a company
I'm constantly amazed. I love it when I text you. Hey, Paul, how you doing? You want to play golf tomorrow? I can't, Fred. I'm in Sweden. Yeah. Just razzle dazzle here. Throw some countries you've been to in the last couple of years.
Here's what happened. So these guys, I had a bunch of job offers when I left the MTA, and I picked this one because it looked like the most fun. And they asked me, what would you like to do? And I said, I want to write, I want to speak, I want to travel, and I want to help my fellow CEOs improve their transit systems around the country. We'd won a bunch of awards when I was at the MTA in Baltimore for various things. We were the safest transit system in America at the time.
In Baltimore?
We had no rapes, no murders, no shootings, the lowest number of Part 1 crimes.
Why didn't they make you police commissioner?
I don't know that I want that job.
Run for mayor.
But I had a great police chief. We had a police department of 170 officers when I was at the MTA.
With the transit system.
Yeah, with the transit system. And but anyway, so they said that's great because they're the world's largest transportation technology company. And they really wanted
somebody.
What's
the name of this company again?
Trapeze Group.
Group.
And it's a Canadian company. And they really wanted somebody to be a connector. And to be a thought leader. So that's what they've let me do. So I started a podcast. You know, I did radio for WCTR in Chestertown for 16 years.
And you did it when you were working for the MTA? Didn't you have a radio program?
We did. We had a radio station we started a radio station while I was the MTA. We're the only transit system in America that ran an FM radio station. And it's still there, WTTZ, FM 93.5 FM,
WTTZ. And you had a Sunday morning show in WRNR.
Yeah.
Where a woman interview you every week,
I was on Fox 45 every month. I did a show and all that. Went out at the MTA, talking about all the fun stuff we're doing. I love the media, you know. So when you offer me,
you're good at it,
and
you know, not the biggest thing I find with public officials, and you tell me, is that they are afraid of TV.
Yeah.
John Kennedy taught us in 1960, there's a vehicle to get your message across.
That's right.
Made him president of the United States and made you successful in what you've been doing.
Yeah. So we started a podcast called Transit Unplugged.
Okay.
And the idea is that I'm interviewing CEOs of transit systems around the world. Half hour, we talk about, it's Aristotelian logic, Fred. The Western mind is wired to think in threes, right? Past, present, future.
Okay.
So I just interviewed the CEO of Melbourne's tram system.
Now my wife turned on the TV. Otherwise, she'll never watch it.
It's going to be on in a month or so on my show. And you can find Transit Unplugged anywhere. We're the number one transportation podcast in the world. And we heard,
you get your love of public transportation with your love of TV, podcasts, or the social media. It works out pretty well.
Yes, yeah, boom, it's great,
Let's keep going.
Yeah.
As a kid, did you walk around with little school bus models? Were you interested in transportation as a kid, or is this just something that came
later?
You
know what's funny? Not really.
Okay.
But when I was thinking back, my mom just passed away. Right. For those who don't know,
and the family.
Yeah, yeah. Dr. Shirley Comfort just
woman
passed.
Woman has her PhD. She's running a college.
Yeah.
I mean, I can
She's
see
great.
Where the enthusiasm comes from. Right?
Yeah. So, but I was thinking back because I was writing her eulogy about my first memories. Mm-hmm. And my first memory in my whole life is my mom pushing me on a swing set in the sunshine, probably 2 or 3 years old.
And this is in Queen Anne's County or somewhere
else? This is when I live. I was born in Norfolk, Virginia.
Okay.
We lived there for 5 years before we moved to Maryland. But my second memory, I'm not kidding you, is riding a little choo-choo train in a lady's house that was my mom was getting her hair done at. So it's been in my roots, but I really just fell into it. Irving Pinder, know, when I ran for county commissioner here in 86.
The first time
Yeah, the first time.
Yeah, you were a young man then.
Yeah, and I was ran for the Central Committee. I won for Central Committee, lost for commissioner. But Irving Pinder ran for office too, and we became good buddies, and
okay.
He ended up asking me if I wanted to apply for this transportation job. And that's how I got in. And I've been in it for 33 years
now. So it was a job. It started out as a job that you fell in love with.
Yeah, yeah. I wanted to be in government. I knew that.
Okay.
I wanted to help people. My dad was a minister. I didn't want to go into the full-time, ministry. I never felt like that was my calling. But I did want to help people. And transportation, Fred, really is a way
senior citizens, kids to school,
exactly.
You name it.
Yeah, yeah.
Is not a part of the public sector that you and public transportation are not helping.
That's right.
Whether it's small-time Queen Anne's County or big-time Baltimore.
When I didn't mean to denigrate the work I did in Washington, D.C. for 5 years.
It just wasn't a fit. It wasn't a fit.
But the work itself was wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went to Baltimore and ran the paratransit system there as well as all everything else, we were able to make that, I think, the number one performing paratransit system in the country.
Mm-hmm.
We ran 8,000 trips a day in Baltimore with, hundreds and hundreds, 800 vehicles. We had 96% on-time performance when I left, and the lowest accident frequency rate, one preventable accident per 100,000 miles, of any major paratransit system in the country. There's a guy named Carl Parr, who I put in charge, who now is still running work up in Baltimore, who helped me do this, and we brought in all the technology we needed. It was phenomenal.
He did it the right way.
Yeah. So this is what's happening around the country.
Let's go back to the original question.
All right.
I just like the audience. Let's get their attention.
All right.
Name me some of the. I told you when I text you and you tell me you're in wherever you are.
Yeah, yeah.
Give me a couple of the countries and cities you've been in the last couple of years.
So in the first 3 years of my job, I visited 60 transit systems around the world.
Okay.
More than anyone else in the world that we know of during that time, and they were in places. So I visited 7 transit systems in Australia, 6 transit systems in
the
United Kingdom.
That's one continent.
Yeah.
Now
United
we're in
Kingdom.
England. That's Europe.
Yep.
That's the
I
second
went to,
continent.
Zurich, Switzerland, and Neuhausen, where they were running the world's first autonomous vehicles in public transportation. And my company helped them do it, Trapeze.
And these are vehicles with no drivers. Okay.
Driving. There's somebody in there, like a safety concierge, but they're not driving. And now they're all over the world, just this morning, I was talking with a guy from Neuhausen about potentially doing a second show over there. So I went on site, and interviewed them. I toured the operation. I normally would teach a class to the staff of the transit system. And then interview the CEO for the podcast and all that. Been to Sweden, done shows. Just recently, I've done shows all over Africa with African leaders.
So we've got Europe covered.
Yeah,
we have
Asia,
Australia covered. We've got Asia covered.
Just interviewed the head of Singapore's transit system. And just this month, we're entering into Latin America.
You've probably been in every continent except for Antarctica.
That's right.
Is Antarctica coming up in the future?
Yeah,
penguins need public.
Yeah, and all over America and Canada. So Transit Unplugged, if it's Wednesday, it's Transit Unplugged. That's my show. So every week, we have a different show on. And you can subscribe. It's free. It's just fun. It's good information about
people,
public transportation.
I mean, I get a kick at it. I'll text you and say, hey, Paul, how about golf? No, Fred, I'm doing a Zoom to Tanzania.
Yeah, yeah.
If people want to get on that podcast, what do they do? You're just saying...
Just Google Transit Unplugged. We have our own website, plus we're on Apple, iTunes, Google. There's 100 platforms now where you can get a podcast.
Okay.
It's audio. It's just audio only. It's not, a lot of times I tape it video, and you can find some of our stuff on YouTube, but the show itself is audio only, yeah. And then part of that was... I was able to write this book.
So as if you didn't have enough to do, you decided I'm going to write a book.
That's right. Talk about
the book.
So this went to number one in the world on public transportation. It's called The Future of Public Transportation. It's a long book, but it's me and 40 of the world's leading experts. I wrote it and gathered 40 of my friends from around the world, you know, from Australia, the guy from Monash University, Dr. Graham Curry, to major CEOs of transit systems. And it's all about the future of what's coming in public transportation.
What is
and
what
the
is
the future
coming?
Is bright. Yeah. Oh, okay. So let me ask them to go to the last slide.
Okay, all right. Guys, good lesson. By the way, if someone's watching this show and says, Paul won't play golf with me.
Yeah.
Paul won't...
One more back.
How do we get the book?
So this book, you can go one more. This book, you can get at Edwards Pharmacy. Boom, right there.
Right
and my children's book, right here in town, if you want to go locally, or go on Amazon. All my books are for sale
so
on
we can
Amazon.
Give them the title again.
The Future of Public Transportation. And then the other book for kids is Public Transportation from the Tom Thumb Railroad to Hyperloop and
Which
Beyond.
Which is my favorite.
Yeah,
Which
and it's a great... It I did it as my COVID lockdown project. Yeah. I crowdsourced the artwork. I ended up working every Sunday. I had a Zoom date with my artist.
By the way, it's
in India.
A delightful book, not only for the illustrations, but the
little
words.
Stories.
Oh, it's
yeah, great. It tells kids and grown-ups all about public transportation, how it started. It's being used all over the world. Some teachers are using it for curriculum. My other book that's fun is Full Throttle. I wrote this right after I left the MTA, and it's me and nine of my friends who are CEOs of transit systems. I wrote 21 chapters. Each of them wrote one about decisions we had to make to get to the top. And, you know, it hasn't been smooth sailing for me. Anybody who's followed my career knows I've been bumped out of the boat a couple times because I've been
afraid,
going full throttle. And I'm not afraid to make decisions. I'm not afraid to ruffle feathers.
Well, as county commissioner or county administrator, you want to get things done.
Yeah.
Your buddy Merv Doherty, who we talk about and laugh about. Merv, I tell you what, he was a bull in a china shop, but he got the job
That's
done.
Right.
And I think you wear the same pair of shoes. Well, All go right. back to what you were about to say.
Okay, so let's go back to the slide. I'm going to tell you about what's happening in transportation
Please.
Right now, Fred. Coming
Please.
Out of COVID, if we can go back one more. This is a picture of me when I was at MTA. The mayor of Annapolis was right next to me. This is when I was starting a brand new commuter service between Annapolis and Baltimore, just like the one we did from Kent Island to Annapolis and Baltimore. Now, the reason I use this picture is this was the hottest thing happening right then, 5 years ago, let's say.
Okay.
MTA killed this route during COVID.
Oh, really?
And now they just brought it back.
It was that good.
Because what happened was, when COVID hit, governments put into place, you know, rules that said you can't work in these big city office buildings anymore. So all the commuter services, which are like the trains
basically
and the
buses. Basically, New York City shut
exactly,
down. Yeah.
Went down 5 to 10% of their ridership.
Okay.
The main regular bus services across America stayed around 50% because they said only essential workers should ride. Well, guess who rides the buses?
Okay.
Essential workers.
Right.
These are people that are your pharmacy techs, right? Your janitors, people that work at the water facilities in cities. And so the government figured out, if we didn't have public transportation, our cities wouldn't even be able to run because the employees...
We didn't get a drink of water.
The employees that run the whole infrastructure, most of them use public transit. So the federal government stepped up its funding dramatically. It's been great for us. You know, I'm a fiscal conservative, but I really believe in investments in public infrastructure. You and I both know that the only way big things get done is if the federal government gets involved. Napoleon had to be the one that put in the infrastructure in Paris, right? And the rails, you know, the trains run on time. And so local governments don't have enough money to fully fund. I mean, County Ride would never have been running and still wouldn't be running unless there were federal and state grants. The county commissioners don't have enough money to run. I don't know what the budget is anymore, but it's probably close to $1 million a year or something. Maybe
they can't do high speed rail. They can't do buses.
So the federal government has to get involved. Public transportation has now become a national priority. So I think the investment in transit is going to continue. There's all kinds of things happening in Washington, D.C. right now that I don't agree with, but this is one I do.
Is not the Biden administration, you know, putting millions and if not billions of dollars into public transportation.
Infrastructure, you know, the bipartisan bill that some of these folks worked on, a lot of that's going to be, our infrastructure in America really is falling apart. Our Governor Hogan helped lead that effort,
actually. It's like me. It's old.
Yeah, yeah. So, and then the other cool thing that's happening is something called MaaS, Mobility as a Service and Microtransit. Here's what's happening. Let's use Los Angeles as an example. They've just started a 200-vehicle microtransit project. A good buddy of mine, Josh Schenck, is their director of innovation. And this is basically like paratransit, van service, but bigger vehicles for anyone. My buddy Robbie Mackinnon in Kansas City started one a couple years ago. So you get on your phone and you can plan your trip. You can book your trip and you can pay for your trip all on your phone or on your computer. The vehicle will triangulate your location. The software will. My company has this software too. A lot of companies do, but ours, I think, is the best. It triangulates your location and then it tells you, walk right out here on your curb. A vehicle will be here in 6 minutes to pick you up. There'll be other people on the vehicle, so it's shared rides, so it's not so expensive.
But it's smaller than a big bus.
It's smaller than a big bus. And so as you do things like move your routes around coming out of COVID, because not everybody's riding into the downtown areas anymore, sometimes people get left behind. The microtransit makes sure they don't. Okay. It's a safety net. It provides more equity and inclusion for everyone. We're having these improved smartphone apps, so you can do everything on your phone.
Not only does it do
the bus and the train, Fred, but it can even bring in taxi cabs, Uber, Lyft. A lot of cities have rental bikes now.
Just do it from your house on the phone.
All on your phone. You can plan. It's amazing. That's the new trend coming out of here. The other thing that's happening, I took a road trip a couple months ago down to and visited 6 transit systems, my first trip in a year, and went to Richmond and North Carolina and Charleston, and then a couple systems in Jacksonville and in Palm Beach. And in Palm Beach, Florida leads the country in pedestrian deaths. Makes sense, right? There's a lot of elderly folks walking
and retirees,
across streets, right? Yeah. Right. And so walkable, pedestrian-friendly, and bike-friendly cities is really a key trend happening.
Well, I read the New York Times. They're closing down streets in downtown Manhattan.
You got it.
And all the 5 boroughs, everything. They're saying, no, we don't want cars anymore, okay? I'm going to get you to the golf course. Don't
That's
worry.
Good.
I'm going to stop.
That's what it's the other side of my head, yeah.
Good. Keep going.
Yeah.
But this has become a real hot
It has.
Ticket
11 item. Cities shut down their city centers during COVID, and a lot of them are keeping them shut down. Some cities are adding in a lot of bike lanes. They're adding in more pedestrian-friendly downtowns. It's wonderful. Public transportation now has really changed, Fred. It's become now, we're calling it mobility.
Okay. You can get on a bike.
Right.
You can get on a minibus. You can get on a big bus.
It's not just buses anymore. And what's the goal of public transportation? Really, COVID has provided an inflection point for all these transit leaders to say, what are we really doing this for? And what we're doing it for is not just to get commuters in and out of their big downtown office buildings. It's really to provide access to all of life's opportunities.
The services, whether it's
people.
A beach or
exactly.
It's a library. Right?
Yeah, so it doesn't have to be on a bus. It doesn't have to be on a train.
Yeah.
It can be the private companies that come in. There's a lot of contractors. One of the hats I wear now is I am executive director of a group called the North American Transit Alliance. It's a big group of 6 of the nation's biggest contractors. These are companies, First Transit, Transdev, National Express, RATP Dev, MV Transportation, Keolis. And they manage city transit systems, and the 6 CEOs formed an association. We have 130,000 employees. I'm the head of the association. And the goal is to show governments that if you get the private sector involved and help us, let us contract out some of this work, like we did in Baltimore and other places.
It's going to make the system work better.
Yeah. We can do it cheaper, usually 20% cheaper. They're still unionized. The cities like to have everything unionized,
well,
which is
fair. It amazes me now. I can go into D.C. I can take a bus or my private car to the metro stop, then get on public transportation on a metro, get off metro, rent a bike, pedal to a Smithsonian,
and then
get on Uber to take me back to the metro stop.
That's
so
right.
We've done privately owned vehicles, mass transit, bicycles, and help Uber. Come on, something's...
This is it.
Yeah,
this
the
is the new mobility.
Yeah.
Nat Ford, my buddy who runs Jacksonville Transit and was head of the APTA, the American Public Transit Association, a few years ago, really introduced this topic to the public transit industry. And it was, you know what? Our role is no longer just to provide transportation in a city or in a region. It's to be the aggregator of all the mobility services.
And you think this
public
is the future.
And we can put it all on a smartphone app. Dallas has done it.
Right.
My buddy down there, David Leininger, led the effort to put it all on an app. I think it's the best in the country. You add in autonomous vehicles. They're not for everything, but for 24-hour campus shuttle systems in the heat of Houston, hey, maybe that makes sense, you know?
Sure.
You don't have to have a driver on the vehicle. You're taking kids from the parking lot into their campus, you know. Then high-speed rail. Boom, baby. Now it's not just what's happening in the maglev, but Sir Richard Branson has his company Virgin has bought up Brightline trains. And here in America, they're building 200-mile-per-hour trains from Las Vegas to Los Angeles and from Miami to Orlando. I just went down and visited the site down there.
This is actually
happening.
Shovels in the
ground. It was already running before COVID. They had to shut it down because no one was riding.
Okay.
But they are building new rails. So the high-speed rail, the private sector, no public except to help, you know, organize like they normally do, land use and all that kind of stuff.
So with this gentleman, I can fly to the moon, I can take a high-speed train, and I fly Virgin Airlines.
Yeah, and the other big billionaire that's doing things is, of course, our friend Elon Musk, who started out this concept called Hyperloop. Here's what it is, and this is why my book is called, you know, From the Tom Thumb Railroad to Hyperloop and Beyond. It's the next phase of public mobility.
So tell us, what is it?
It's a tube where they suck all the air out of it, so you're like you're
it's
in
a
outer
vacuum.
Space.
It's in a vacuum.
And it's on rail, and it's a train on rail in a vacuum tube, and in theory, it could go 600 miles per hour. They've invited me to their Las Vegas test site. They've gotten up to, I don't know, 250 miles per hour, but they're building tunnels all over the Las Vegas, other places, and, you know, hundreds of cities around the world believe this is more science now than fiction.
Okay.
And so it's happening. The other one, the last one, is VTOL. Vertical takeoff.
Let me just, before you go, the Hyperloop, is it working anywhere in the world now?
No,
okay.
No.
We're still experimenting.
It's all experimental. They've run test tracks. They've got up to certain speeds, but it's not in actual service yet. I met the CEO of the company that Elon has a company. Then there's another company owned by Sir Richard Branson. They're like in a friendly competition on this Hyperloop. They feel like it'll be done the next 5 to 10 years. It'll be in service. I just did an interview with the CEO of Dubai Transit System, and you know,
they
over
have
there in the Middle East,
they'll
got tons
it.
Of money.
They'll do it.
So it's moving forward, man. I can't wait to ride it. It's going to be amazing.
And how fast does it go?
It'll probably go up to 300 miles per hour to start with, and then it will go faster and faster.
You led a delegation, and I was fortunate to be on the county in China.
Yeah.
How fast were we going in a high-speed rail?
We were going 327 miles per hour.
So 100, 200, 300 miles an hour.
Yeah. It's
not an issue.
They're happening. Governor Hogan went over to Japan where they were doing it, and they're trying to do that over between Baltimore and Washington, but still a lot of studies going on.
Go ahead.
The last one is vertical takeoff and landing. Again, this isn't for everybody. It's basically a helicopter.
Okay.
But it looks like a Osprey, you know, the military Osprey vehicles.
Right.
Where it
just goes straight up.
Two of them. Yeah. So the idea here is, I was down with Nat Ford in Jacksonville, and he said, "Paul, we're going to have this very soon." Basically, it's privately run. So somebody flies into Jacksonville, they want to go to the Mayo Clinic. They fly in, they need some special treatment, they get on the special helicopter-type vehicle, vertical takeoff and landing. It takes them there real fast and drops them off at the top. They don't parachute down, they land. Drops them off at the roof of the...
I'm not jumping.
So here's what's going to happen, though. This is what I predict.
Go ahead.
By the end of this century, you and I, if we're still alive, will be able to call a VTOL to our house unmanned.
Just come and land in your front yard.
It'll land in my front yard for $99. I'll be able to get out, get in it. It'll take me and drop me off at Union Station in downtown D.C. So when it's in a hurry, you know, it's not going to be for everybody. Like the Lexus lanes aren't over, you know, around.
It's going to cost a couple bucks at the beginning.
Yeah, but it gets cars off the road. It's part of the whole solution, the mobility aggregation solution we talked about.
So it looks
this
like,
is what's coming just
so,
over the horizon.
Paul, it looks like your whole transportation area, a whole new chapter is about to open up.
Yes.
The technology is going to be different. I like what you've been telling us about the idea that we're going to combine private enterprise with the feds, who we know Chinese government had to build that railroad, a high-speed railroad, right? But we can do a combination of both.
We need it.
Yeah, so
we need it here in America. It takes too long to build things. The infrastructure needs to be updated in America, and the transportation infrastructure is really key for us to come out of COVID, to be honest with you, and to come to this new economy we're coming to, which is going to be hybrid in nature. So I was talking to one of the guys in London the other day, and he said, "Paul, so many people are working from home now. We're adjusting our bus routes to have more midday service outside of the city, because people in the suburbs need to get to restaurants now in the middle of the day. They need to get to the dry cleaners. So the whole model of how public transportation is run is changing, and I'm super excited to work for a company that allows me to be right at the front of it."
Now, Paul, your wife is waiting for you. You're going to pick her up, so I got about a minute left.
Okay.
Let's go over a couple things. One, if they want to get on your podcast, what do they do again?
So I have a website called futureofpublictransportation.com. It's on the last slide. You can check out all my books and all the stuff I'm writing, everything there. The podcast is transitunplugged.com. Just go to that, or you can find it on Apple iTunes. Subscribe to it. It's fun. And then I write a lot for all the industry magazines, but also my company has a blog site. Or if I can, I'm on social media. If you don't follow me on LinkedIn, I have 20,000 followers. I think I'm number one in the world for public transportation leaders. Follow me on LinkedIn. I put something up every day, something cool about public transportation, trending.
Interesting facts.
Yeah. You got it, yep. If I can ever be of any help or talk to your group, if you're listening to this and you're like, "Hey, Paul, could you talk about transit trends?" Email me, paul.comfort@trapezegroup.com. Happy to do it free of charge. charge. I love doing this stuff. And I'm a transit evangelist.
30 seconds I have left. Again, if you want to get your books.
Yeah, Amazon. Just Google Paul Comfort, books, Amazon, public transportation.
And if that's too complicated for you, you can go down to Edwards Pharmacy in Centerville and say, hey, I'd like to get some of these guys'
books. It's right there in the local author section.
Okay.
And I want to tell you, Fred, this county's been so good to me. I want to thank the people of the county who have, I've grown up here. My life has been here. I love this county. Good. And I love the work that you're doing, QACTV. You guys are doing amazing here and happy to be part of it again.
Well, look, first of all, thank you for coming to the program. Condolences over the death of your mom. We're all very
thank
sorry.
You.
And we've got 10 seconds. Lisa is waiting, okay?
That's right.
Okay. I'm Fred McNeil. Thank you for watching Conversations with Fred. My time's up. Thank you for your time. We're going to see you next time.